Hi everyone, I'm Manana and I'm gonna talk about data for social good in the world and in Armenia, something that is a little bit of philosophy of how to use data science in general, and I kind of want to share these ideas with you today. So in the beginning, I'll tell a little bit about myself and my journey and how I became a data scientist. Obviously, when I was just born, I didn't know what I was gonna do. I lived in Norhacan. It's like a very small town next to Yerevan. I had like the most normal kid life. I had like an amazing childhood, played a lot of hide and seek, gorts na gorts and all of that. Went to my local school, and I guess everything changed when I got accepted to UWC Dilijan College, and that was like a turning point in my academic career, in a way, the things that I would imagine for myself. Dilijan changed everything, and I started dreaming of getting a better education, becoming like this better professional, whatever it would mean. I became like increasingly more ambitious there. And in 2016, I got accepted to Berkeley. When I got accepted to Berkeley, I was thinking of myself as an economist, and I 100% was sure that I was going to be an economist and do econ PhD. But then something changed in Berkeley, because everyone was coding in Silicon Valley, and it was such a casual talk to just talk about data science or like artificial intelligence for lunch or dinner. I started being really jealous that I didn't know how to code after my first semester, and I took coding classes just because I wanted to keep up with my friends. But then I fell in love with computer science, and I was also taking a lot of stats and math for economics. And I don't know how, but at the end of my 4 years, I discovered that I had like a full-on data science degree completed. So I ended up getting two majors at Berkeley, which was economics and data science. Something important that happened while I was studying at Berkeley that also changed my vision about my career was me interning in Pixar. I first interned in the summer of 2018, and I also continued interning in the San Francisco office in the fall of 2018. And this was one of my very good experiences, because when I joined the Pixar team of data scientists, it was new, and I had like I met amazing people there, and I'm sure like I think I've seen Nana's name there, and she gave a talk. But there were like amazing data scientists in Armenia, which really gave me hope and encouraged, motivated me to dive deeper in the field. And I also loved working in the company and doing something good for Armenia. That feeling where you're using your skills and you're doing something good for your country is just like so amazing. That was from Pixar. And no wonders why when I was graduating Berkeley, like that year, where we came together with my friends who were like Armenian and who were also studying data science at Berkeley, and put together this vision of a nonprofit organization which would accelerate the development of data science in Armenia. And why nonprofit and why to accelerate the development of data science? It's because that summer I was traveling to Armenia and I was telling everyone, my friends or my aunts, that I am a data scientist. I got a degree in data science, and I was experiencing this weird silence because people didn't really know what data science was about or what I was going to do. And I even received questions whether I would earn money, like I would earn for my life or not. And I realized that there is a whole gap. Like there are people who are doing data science and they're advanced and ambitious and really great in Armenia, but the general public and society is missing on this data aspect of decision making in general in Armenia. So that's why it was built as a nonprofit organization rather than any for-profit data consulting group. And after that, I got accepted to Harvard to do my master's in data science, where I am currently right now. The picture is with my is with a building that is like new and it's like kind of devoted to data science, because they're spending a lot of money and resources of making like the data hub right now here. And I'm going to concentrate on like machine learning and a little bit of AI. Next year, I will do research on sign language translation into text, or something like, or like to try to solve a problem in that field, which I'm not very certain right now. But that's about me. And now I kind of want to start talking about my vision and data for social good. But before like diving deeper into the data for social good aspect of the presentation, I want to pause a little bit and ask you, what kind of Armenia do you want to build? And I'm asking this question because we as data scientists are not the people who need to do only analyzing of data. Yes, that's part of our daily activities in a way. We do data cleaning, we do analysis, but we should also realize that we have a lot of building power. We do have the knowledge and we do have the capacity to build and influence the country we are living in. And that's why I wanted to start with this question, so you can keep it in mind as I'm doing my presentation. Let me define the data for social good concept, even though it doesn't have like any good definition as data science, the field itself doesn't have. But essentially, when we're saying social good, we're meaning something much bigger, good for the society. So we're creating something that the society as a whole can benefit. And sometimes there are stakeholders in society, such as they can be like people with disabilities, but there can be like environment, which is like not exactly the society, but because we all live in the same, on the same earth and we all are interacting with environment, that will be another place to make social impact. So anything that has with a larger population of people and brings benefits to them is social good. And when we're saying data for social good, we mean bring this computation, data science, AI skills, and create some social good for your society. The way I constructed the presentation is I'll give three very good like examples right now from working papers or like implemented case studies out there in the world, which are showing how data science or like AI is being implemented for social good. And then I'll go ahead and talk about Armenia and social good. The first case study that I want to mention here is the Armor algorithm for more reliable security operations at LAX. LAX is Los Angeles' biggest airport. And our Armor algorithm was a algorithm that was written for AAAI conference in 2008. AAAI is one of the most prestigious conferences for AI in the world. And the cool thing about this algorithm was that LAX actually adopted the system and used this algorithm for making the airport more secure for 10 years almost. And they just recently moved to something even better. What essentially happened was in 2007, there was a major security concern in LAX because there were a lot of terror attacks in other airports. And what happens in each airport, especially in the big ones, is that they have police officer schedules, but they do not have all the resources needed to track all the entrances and exits and all the roads in the airport because the airport is huge. So they can have only X amount of people in certain entrances or certain exits at any time given during the day. Something that is like very shaky about this situation is that the adversary, let's say the terrorists, they observe these patterns of schedules over time. So they have information on the airport, but the airport security cannot observe the adversary. So what happened is that the group of researchers thought about this whole situation as a game theory where you do not have access to your adversary, but your adversary has access to your information. For those who are like more technical, this is Peja Stackelberg game that you can look up. And basically they modeled it as a Stackelberg game where they got a lot of data on airport load during different times of the day. So for example, there are this many people in entrance A at gate B during this time of the day, and there are not that many people in the different entrance. What are the police officer numbers, where we can have these numbers? So they constructed a whole data set with interesting information, and they solved this game, which was also randomized to produce randomized schedules at the end. The LAX applied this algorithm and wrote a software using this algorithm, which would randomize the schedules of police officers every day in the beginning of the day. And they managed to keep LAX safe for 10 years, and they're like without terror attacks, and they moved even to something better, which is like an iteration of this similar algorithm. So that's like a huge stake, as you can see, because like the whole airport security was just bettered by an AI algorithm. The next case study I want to talk about is HIV prevention in homeless youth by social network graph approaches. I have this here to show that AI can be successfully implemented in HIV prevention, or like any other health outcomes that we might want to achieve in the society as a whole. Another interesting paper, which is actually by my professor, Milin Tambe et al. So the idea of this HIV prevention, or like the motivation, was because there are 4.2 million youth in the US who are homeless and who struggle from being high risk at HIV. And that's like a very serious number. Giving training or some kind of aid to 4.2 million homeless youth is not the easiest thing, even when you're thinking about the US. Like, the country is resourceful, has like a lot of money, but that requires a lot of resources and a lot of management. And even that needs to be optimized, and AI could actually work here. The way the researchers thought about this problem was to have a social network graph approach. So the case study was done in only one city with group of homeless youth. But the idea was that we will construct a social network graph of these people, collecting a lot of data on them and understanding what are the connections between them, what they're doing, what are their daily habits, basically everything they could get from this youth. And then we will write an AI algorithm, which is social network optimization, influence optimization algorithm, that will go into this graph and find all the nodes that have the most influence on this graph. Then we will select this node and we will give the training to only these nodes and observe these people over time and see what is the impact of this influence maximization algorithm technique. Is it useful or not? And the paper shows that this approach is 60% more accurate, or in a way more effective, than all the previous approaches that have been done when people would go and try to give HIV prevention to only those people who already had HIV, who were already HIV positive, or when they were trying to give HIV training to everyone and were not having enough resources to cover larger populations. So what they found is that using the AI algorithm of influence maximization with social networks, they were able to maximize the HIV prevention in larger network of youth using little resources. And that's pretty amazing, because like this is like already a step forward of solving one of the most sensitive issues among homeless youth in the United States. And the last case study I want to talk about is about industrial smoke prevention using computer vision. And this is a paper which is not exactly, it's published, but not published yet in the AAA conference, but is in the registration track in a way. And the paper is interesting, and I want to introduce this paper for two reasons. First, because it was it's going to be part of specifically social impact track of AAAI conference, and I wanted to mention today that even these conferences that care a lot about algorithms and data science development, they have specifically social track because they want to encourage researchers apply this algorithm in the society or like on social problems. And the second is that the paper is for like this prestigious conference, but it does not add anything algorithm wise and only constructs data, which is very unique and novel. And it's interesting because I'm mentioning this because in Armenia we do not take data collection seriously and we do not have a rigorous ways of collecting data, but apparently people are encouraged even to collect data in novel ways and apply to conferences, and that is being appreciated as well. And I wanted to kind of have that remark in my presentation. Now about this industrial smoke prevention using computer vision. I think this case study is very self-explanatory in a way that they used a bunch of neural networks, LNets, and so on and so forth to just have all these like videos and images of industrial smoke and classify them as if were there in the industrial smoke or not. And what is being done with this case study is the local government is actually implementing this algorithm, and they're trying to set up a continuous way of taking pictures of industrial places and trying to understand whether smoke is too heavy and there should be more regulations in that certain place or not, because industrial smoke has an impact on human health, and it's really important for social local governments to know when they need to make the regulations and when the industrial smoke is having a very bad negative impact. So yes, but the novel part of the algorithm and the whole paper is coming from the fact that they actually recruited the whole society to make these pictures. In a way, they had many volunteers who volunteered to take videos and pictures and populate this data set by taking the picture, but also labeling whether there was an industrial smoke and it was heavy or not. So the novel approach is that this whole society actually kind of crowdsourced these images to create that database. And that's another interesting approach of bringing data to society and trying to make a step forward by actually including the society as well. So if you have questions, I'll have like 5 to 10 minutes at the end of the presentation so you can ask me about the papers and algorithms. And now I'm gonna come back to Armenia and kind of start. The Armenia I wanna build actually has all these features. I do understand that data science is such a hot field, and if you're a data scientist in a tech company, you can make so much money. But I also want to state that data science is really important for society and for solving the social issues. So the Armenia I want to build is exactly Armenia, who has all this capacity of applying data science for larger issues that we are facing. And Datapoint Armenia, as I mentioned in the beginning, actually came to life to solve or like to try to bridge this gap. What we're doing in Datapoint Armenia, I'll just like have very short description of the way the organization is working right now and the projects we have done and we're doing right now. And I'm really happy that if you had a chance to hear what Lilith was talking, she presented one of our very interesting projects, which was on misinformation during the war with using Twitter data. But coming back, Datapoint Armenia started as nonprofit organization with different committees, because data science is such an interdisciplinary field, and we needed to accommodate at least a couple of other fields to apply data science. We have currently data and economics, we have data and health, we have data and language, which is concerned about Armenian and data science and how to apply data science, natural language processing to Armenian. And we also have data science projects, which is a committee with concerned more about like machine learning applies to different areas that couldn't be committees yet because we do not have equal amount of field professionals and data scientists. In most of the other committees, we have either like field professional advisors who can advise us on the field we're working with, or like committee members are equally from data science and the field itself. Some of the projects we have completed include creating data science dictionary for Armenian, because it's really hard to talk about data science in Armenian. Most of the terms are in English, and it's even harder to do research in data science and write a paper in Armenian because the terms were not there. But we have translated 300 terms with cooperating with linguists and data scientists, and and if you need to use it, you can like email me or like reach out to me right now. But if you wait like in a couple of weeks, it will be open sourced in our website and everyone will have access to the dictionary. We also created a business analytics workshop for beginners to show how data science can be applied in decision making to beginners, to kind of motivate people to get into the field. Right now, we also have a data and education workshop series that we are preparing, and those are going to be translated in Armenian, so we can have like, we can in a way like decrease that friction between Armenian language and data science. We have a NLP spell check for Armenian, where we're trying to create an extension on browser that can be easily applied with everyone who type Armenian. And with this, we kind of want to encourage people type more Armenian and not with English letters. And we're hoping that if there is like a spell check that helps people and autocomplete that helps people, people will start typing Armenian more. There are a couple of like interesting impact data and econ projects we're working on. One being the impact analysis before and after war, and we are cooperating with Ministry of Economy. In data and health, we are doing a historic analysis of all the crises that happened in the world and policies of how governments could get over with the crisis, and basically try to understand, like analyzing data, try to understand the effective ways of crisis management. We also have a health classification project where we're going to use medical records, electronic medical records from Armenia to aid in decision making. And a lot of projects here and there, we're excited to work. If you have that capacity and a volunteering motivation to come and join it, make this happen with us, we'll be happy to have you in our network. And I have a couple of sources of how to get involved with DataCoin Armenia at the end.
Mananajan, what do you think? Can we like go to questions so we can have also some questions for you and run to next speaker?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I'm actually done with my presentation. I just wanted to have a couple of areas that I can just say that Armenia needs a lot. Like AI-driven agriculture, data-driven economy, data-driven city management and urban data science to just improve cities, AI for security, and I know a lot of people are thinking about the last one currently, but these are the areas that need a lot right now. And I wanted to leave a cliche quote, which is data is the new oil, and because we as Armenians, like we say all the time, like we do not have the oil, times are changing, we actually can be the ones of the oil if we take this tech and data approach. And these are the resources after my presentation is shared with you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. Any questions for her?
Hi, I really liked your presentation. I was just wondering, what was your motivation for making Datapoint Armenia kind of eventually open source, like making the data available to everybody, instead of trying to partner with for-profits or smaller companies to try and monetize the data sets? Like, why, what compelled you to make sure that it was available to everybody? And do you intend to keep it that way?
Yeah, that's a good question. We actually need to figure out like more ways to be sustainable, but the whole motivation is to be, can you mute for a minute and the one other thing?
I'm quite far, just a minute.
Yeah, thank you so much. The whole motivation was that we're bringing volunteers who put their time of efforts of creating something good for Armenia, and we wanted to do it like open source for everyone, so everyone could benefit. So I can say like it was purely altruistic. I was not thinking about profits, and no one was thinking about profits in the organization. We just wanted to do something good for Armenia, and that was the pure motivation. And I know that might sound like a little naive as well from our side, but we all wanted to give back to country, and we were realizing that Armenia is missing out on this. And if we made it a non-profit and even like put prices on data sets, I don't think we would make the larger impact that we wanted to make. We would have like a lot of people joining us, we wouldn't. And we wanted to raise awareness and engagement with data science. And if something has a price tag, that's already a barrier to access it. So we definitely didn't want to introduce more barriers, but we wanted to.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mananajan. This was the last question because we are running out of time. Thanks a lot for joining.